Here are 10 of the most powerful ways to lower your blood pressure that science has figured out. Your doctor told you to reduce the salt. Cut the salt. And reducing salt does help lower blood pressure. Many clinical trials have shown that. But there is something even better. Our blood pressure is controlled by the balance between sodium and potassium. Sodium raises it, potassium lowers it. So we can take advantage of this by using replacement salts where some of the sodium is replaced with potassium. Some people don't like the taste of potassium chloride. They think it tastes a little metallic. To be honest, I don't notice the difference. I have a replacement salt that's 100% potassium chloride, and to me, it tastes all the same, just tastes salty. But some people definitely notice the difference. So there are other brands that have mixes, like 50-50, for example. Even swapping just 25% of the sodium with potassium has shown very impressive benefits. 13% lower risk of stroke and 12% lower risk of dying in general, total death, with just 3 millimeters mercury, just a 3-point drop in systolic blood pressure. And this was over 5 years in people with high blood pressure at baseline. Another trial using potassium salts found a reduction in cardiovascular events like heart attacks or strokes of 40% with a blood pressure reduction of 7 points, 7 millimeters mercury. In this second trial, the total number of deaths, the all-cause mortality, was not significantly reduced, although this trial was a lot shorter and a lot less people, so it might just be a statistical issue. Bottom line is that even modest reductions in blood pressure can lead to very substantial benefits if the reduction is sustained over years. All right, before we move on to the second tip, a couple caveats of potassium salts. People with chronic kidney disease can have a hard time excreting potassium normally, and so we can accumulate and the blood levels can rise. We have a whole video on that going into it in more detail, but if you have kidney issues, kidney diseases, please talk to your doctor before starting a potassium salt. Also, some prescription meds can interact with potassium salts and cause potassium levels in the blood to rise. So please discuss with your doctor any prescription meds you're on and whether a potassium salt is right for you. And the last caveat, salt is one of the main sources of iodine in the Western diet. So if you're going to go for a replacement, choose an iodized replacement or bear this in mind. Make sure you're getting enough iodine from other sources. All right, enough about potassium salts. The second tip in today's video is about the food itself. Most of the sodium in our diets actually doesn't come from salt we add at the table or during cooking. It's in ultra-processed foods where the sodium is added during production. Some of the main sources of sodium in the Western diet are breads, pizza, cold cuts, and snacks like potato chips. And if we add restaurant food, these two alone account for 75% of the sodium in our diet. This means that eating home-cooked meals, mainly made up of whole foods or lightly processed foods, gets rid of the bulk of the sodium and helps lower blood pressure, as well as bringing a number of other benefits. Okay, number three, we can't talk about blood pressure and diet without mentioning the DASH diet. DASH stands for Dietary Approaches to Stop Hypertension, and as the name indicates, it was developed to help people control their blood pressure. It's a modified Mediterranean diet favoring fruits and vegetables, whole grains, legumes, lean protein, and low-fat dairy. Clinical trials have shown a reduction in blood pressure of 5 to 6 points systolic when people were swapped onto a DASH diet. When we talk about these numbers, these ranges, bear in mind this is average for large populations, so individual results may vary. Also, in general, people who have higher blood pressures are going to experience bigger drops with some of these changes. There are many factors that may explain the effect of the DASH diet on blood pressure. One of them is the potassium content of the foods that make up the diet. Interestingly, the effect of DASH seems additive with the effect of sodium. So one clinical trial, for example, saw a 5 to 6 point reduction when people were put on DASH and an additional 3 points dropped when the sodium was cut further. All right, enough about foods. Let's talk exercise. You've been told to exercise to lower your blood pressure, but probably nobody told you which type of exercises are the best. And it turns out it makes a huge difference. So walking, for example, lowers systolic blood pressure by about 3 points, weightlifting by about 4 to 5, cardio, like running or biking, by 6 or 7, and isometric exercise, like wall squats, for example, by up to 10 points We have a whole video on this with the protocols, with all the details, so I'll link that at the end. Tai Chi is another exercise that has been shown to be very effective in helping lower blood pressure, possibly because it has elements of isometric exercise. Tip number 5 is probably something you have not heard. Just taking breaks from sitting can help lower blood pressure significantly. A recent trial got people to reduce the amount of time they spent sitting down by about 30 minutes a day. They did this by encouraging the use of standing desks and also by giving the participants a fitness tracker that prompted them to take breaks from sitting down. And their blood pressure was reduced by 3.5 points. So it's in the ballpark of light exercise. So even people who can't do strenuous physical activity, people with advanced age, for example, people with certain physical limitations, even just taking breaks from sitting down and kind of stretching your legs and walking around the house can significantly lower blood pressure. Tip number 6 is weight loss. Losing some excess fat mass can reduce blood pressure significantly. 3 points for a loss of 5% body weight, or 1 point per kilogram. Again, this is average, so individual results may vary. When we lose weight, our cardiac output is reduced, the function of our sympathetic nervous system, insulin resistance, all these things come down, all of which can influence blood pressure. Think about how complementary all of these different tips are. So a healthy diet and exercise can both help lower blood pressure and both help lose some weight, which by itself lowers blood pressure some more. So by putting all of these things together, you can really get some large drops in your blood pressure. Number 7 is alcohol. Regular drinking in substantial amounts raises blood pressure. A meta-analysis of 36 clinical trials found that people having more than 2 drinks a day, so a pretty regular and large amount of drinking, reduced their blood pressure by up to 5.5 points by cutting back on the booze. On the other hand, people who drink less, up to 1 or 2 drinks a day, they saw no significant change in blood pressure when that was reduced further. It might still benefit cardiovascular health in other ways. Some evidence indicates that it does, but for blood pressure specifically, not much of an effect. Number 8 is smoking. The relationship between smoking and blood pressure is actually kind of complex. I was surprised to learn this recently. Nicotine raises heart rate and it also raises blood pressure acutely right after smoking, but the effect long-term on hypertension varies. Some studies show an increase, some studies don't. Of course, there are plenty of reasons to quit smoking for artery and heart health, but the effects on blood pressure specifically long-term, some variability there. Number 9, sleep disturbances have been tied to higher blood pressure, and stress has also been tied to blood pressure elevations. So working on improving sleep quality and lowering stress levels by avoiding stressful activities during the day can help optimize blood pressure. The practice of mindfulness and meditation has also been shown in clinical trials to help lower blood pressure. So try to zen it up. Number 10 is caffeine. This one is also a bit complex because it varies a lot from person to person. And also the hypertensive effects of caffeine seem to go away long-term in habitual coffee drinkers. That said, some people are just more sensitive to caffeine than others. So if you have blood pressure issues, it's worth a shot to switch to decaf for a while and see how that affects you. So those are the 10 tips. Now for some people, all of that might still not be enough. We don't all have the same genetics, and there's no shame in that. Blood pressure lowering medication is a valid, effective option for people who need it and has been shown to lower blood pressure. Events like heart attacks and strokes and even all-cause mortality, total mortality in people who have high blood pressure. So work with your doctor on integrating those if you need them. Here's that video on the best workouts to lower blood pressure. And here's one on replacement salts going over a lot more detail. Check those out. I'll see you over there. Bye.